Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum everyone. Today we are going to conduct lecture number 19 of our course. And today's topic is stake, its concept, and its important registers which are involved in a stake process. And we will be discussing all these concepts from the point of view of PIC. So let's start our topic. Okay, first of all, we will try to answer a question: why do we need a stake? So to answer that question perfectly, we will write a code, and we will try to place the code in the program memory perfectly, and then we will use how program counter will be pointing to the next instruction. Okay, I have written the code for this specific concept. So let's write the code instructions first. So accept an 8-bit information. That is the instruction we are given with. So we have to accept an 8-bit information from port B. That means port B will serve as input port, and we will receive 8-bit information. And call a subroutine. So we have to call a subroutine right in the main code, which will perform what? Which will double the input value. So the subroutine we are going to call in the main program will double the value, or will make it twice, right? So whatever the value received from port B is going to be double using this subroutine, and then send this double value to port D. So what we have to do, we have to send this double value to port D, which is being doubled using this subroutine. So let's see what we are doing here. First, code is starting here. This is our assembler directive. It is not instruction, right? Originate 00 hex. That means we will be starting our program memory at the address 00. And at 00, we will be writing the very first instruction, which is move literal to working 00. So what is going to happen? Working register will become 00, and we are saving it to Christy. So move working file Christy. That means these two lines are written just to make the port D as output port, as it is dictated, because we have to send the port the double value to port D. That means port D will be output, and these two lines, these first two lines, are written for this purpose, right? And then again, we have to use what? This is just a label, so I will ignore it. The third instruction is move F port B comma W, right? So we have to actually copy the content of port B, which is input port, right? Whatever the data coming from port D, we are sending it to working register. Now that value which is received is stored in working register after the execution of this instruction. Then we are using call double. So call is instruction which is used to call a subroutine, and subroutine name is here in this exact, in this case, is double. So call instruction will switch the control from the main program to the subroutine whose name is double. So now we will look for this double keyword or double label, because it will be name of the subroutine. So we will look in the same program. So we find it here, double. Okay, we come to this point, double. Okay, I will be explaining all code, but I am coming to here in this point. So this is the double. So now program counter or program microcontroller will switch to this instruction after this name. This is again a name, so we will not execute it. It is just letting us know that, okay, this is the start of double subroutine. So first instruction is move WF. That means whatever the value we have received, we are moving that value in working register, and value is moved into 00 hex. So now file register 00 hex contain also the value of working register. If you remember, the input value was sent to the working register, and now what we are doing, we are sending this working register to 00 hex, and then in the next line what we are doing, add WF, right? That means whatever the value of working register, which is what? Input value W, right? And we are adding it to 00 hex. That means W is already stored in 00 hex, and now we are adding to W to 00 hex. That means this value will become double. So for example, port B is we are receiving two value in port B. It will come into W in this instruction, and in this instruction two will also go to 00 hex. So now W and 00 hex both contain two So what will happen in the next this line? Add working with file. So working and file, which file? 00hex. And 00hex has two value and w has two value. So both will add it and 2 plus 2 will become 4. So in this is the logic we are trying to develop to make it double. So and that result, again, we are storing in w. So this time, after the execution of this instruction, the working register will value will become double, right? And then we are using this return statement. You know that return statement is used to go back to the main program. So we will go back to the main program. And do what instruction? After the instruction which is written after call, right? So move WF. So W value is now doubled. So now double value, which is present in the working register, is sending to the file. What file? Port D, which is our output port. So in this way, we are displaying the double value to the output port. And then what we are doing, branch again and again is shifting here. So we are repeating this stuff, right? And this is the normal fashion for a microcontroller or embedded system that we will, whenever they turn on, they will run this their code for indefinite time period interval, right? So let's understand these assembler directives value, and let's place this code in program memory. Now what I have done, I have just placed their addresses against each instruction. So very first instruction is starting at 00hex because we can see this originate 00hex, which means we have to start our code in program memory at this address, which is 00hex. So very first instruction, which is move literal to working, will be written at what address? 00hex. So that is why its address is 00, right? Okay, these addresses are written in hex. Okay, so this is 00hex. Okay, the next, and the first instruction, which is move literal to working, is 2 byte. We have already learned that most of the instruction in the PIC18F microcontroller are of 2 byte only, right? So move literal to working is 2 byte instruction. So we know that if one is going to write, if we consider the first byte will be written on 00, so next byte will be written on 01. So that is why these 2 bytes will consume in this move literal to working. So next instruction which will be written, move WF, written on 02. So since it is again 2 byte instruction, so 02 and 03, these two addresses, okay, these are two single addresses, right? Two addresses will consume because it is again 2 byte instruction. Next we go to again is a label, it is not an instruction, we will not encode it, right? So move f is again 2 byte instruction, so its address will be 04, but it will be written on 2 bytes, 04 and 05. I hope you understand it. And then the next instruction, call. I told you in the last lecture, call is 4 byte instruction, so it will be consuming 4 bytes. So its address would be 06, but it will take 06, 07, right, 08, and 09. So these are the 4 bytes which were consumed in call instruction only. Then the next instruction, whose address would be after this 09, so address would be 0A. Remember, we are writing these addresses in hexadecimal, so after 9, we come to 0A. Which is equivalent to decimal 10, right? So move WF is again 2 byte instruction. So 0A will be its address, but 0A and 0B, these are the two locations which will be used in this instruction. Similarly, we will move onwards. The branch again is unconditional branch, but it is a short branch. It takes only 2 bytes. If you remember, we have also discussed there is a long branch, which is go to branch. So short branch takes 2 bytes, go to branch, which is long branch, it takes 4 bytes. But here we are using only short branch, so it will consume 2 bytes. 0B was consumed in move working F. So 0C would be the next address, and 0C and 0D. These 2 bytes will be consumed in this instruction. I hope you understand it, right? Why I'm doing so? Because this concept or these addresses are very important once you are going to deal with stake. So that is why we are trying to understand this concept. Then we will write double. Then what we are doing, this is very important. Very first time we are using originate directive in middle of the code. So This is the another use of this originate. You can, for example, after whatever, after this short branch, whatever the code we want to return, we don't want to return in the same in the consecutive addresses. Rather, we can save it some other. So we define, okay, now whatever the data or whatever the instruction we are going to write, it will stay on 100 hex, right? So that is why this instruction double is the name. We will not be encoding it, but instruction is move WF. So it is 2-byte instruction, but it will be written on 100x. For example, if I would not have written it, what will be the address of move WF? Since 0D has consumed, so it should be stored as 0E, which is the consecutive address. But now we are using originate just to make, just to write it some with some space with the main code. Okay, this is the only logic here. And I, why I'm doing, because I want to place a larger code in the program memory. So I'm writing our code with the spaces, right? So move WF will be written on 100 hex, but we know that it is a 2-byte instruction. So 100 and 101 will get consumed. So next address would be 102, which is the address of add WF, which is again 2-byte instruction. So 102 and 103, these 2 bytes are consumed in add working file. Then we come to return instruction, is a 2-byte instruction. 103 is already consumed in add working file. So return instruction will be written on 104 and 106, sorry, 105. And then assembler directive. So I'm writing 106 with assembler directive and, right? But it is not the address of assembler directive. Remember, assembler directive is not an instruction. 106 is the next free byte, or is the free space available in the program. I'm just writing it to show that return statement is 2-byte statement. So 104 and 105, both are consumed in return. So next free byte available after return statement would be 106 hex. I hope this point is clear. So I have written instructions, addresses. Why I have done so? That is the thing to understand, and that is related with our topic, which is called state. So let's figure out why I'm doing so. So very first thing, you know that instructions are executed one by one. So very first instruction, which is going to be executed, move literal to working. So this is the originate 00. This will be written in the program counter. Before execution, 00 hex will be written. This is the address which will be written in program counter. So program counter content would be what? Content would be 00 hex, okay? When this instruction is fetched and goes under the process of execution, right? So this instruction is being fetched, is fetched already, and now this is under the process of execution. The first line is under execution. We will jump to the next line, but we will not jump, right? Program counter will point this address now. So instead of 00 hex, it will be written 02 hex. So now program counter is pointing to this instruction while first instruction is under execution. So once this instruction finished, what is going to happen? This next instruction will go under execution 02 hex, and program counter will jump to the next instruction, which is 04. So 02 will become 04 hex. So in this way, next instruction target is or next instruction address is stored in the program counter. So that is why we say program counter always keeps the track of the program. Okay, we continue this process. What is going to happen when this instruction finish? This instruction will go under execution. So program counter will switch to this value. So let me write it. So program counter will have 06, which is the address of this next instruction. Okay, when this instruction finishes, we come to this instruction. So 06 will go under the process or execution, and program counter will switch to this instruction, whose address is what? 0A, right? So it will become 0A. I hope you understand it, right? So now once the execution of this instruction, which is this one, right? This is under execution call. When CPU executes it, it will come to know this is a call instruction. We have to leave the main program. We have to leave the code, right? What will happen? It will leave this main code, which is this part, right? and we will switch to double because call instruction is forcing us to go to double. Now, what is the address of this instruction? Is 100 hex, 100 hex. What do we have? Program counter have 0A hex. So that means this 0A hex is not needed now, which was needed in earlier case because we were going in sequential flow of code. But now we need this 100 hex. So what will happen? Call instruction will force program counter to flush out these values, whatever the value content is stored inside program counter. And it will ask to load the value 100 hex because 100 hex is the address at which the next instruction is stored. I hope you understand the call. When then this specific instruction will be processed, then 100 will become 102, then it becomes 104. And when this call return statement will execute it, right? Let me write it clearly. It has become 106 because this return statement is under execution and we are pointing towards the next byte, next free byte. Okay. So when this return statement get executed, what will happen? Now program will, CPU will know, okay, now I have to go back to main code. But can he go back? Can he go back to this address? Which was this is the address which is supposed to loaded in this program counter, right? But it is not possible. Why it is not possible? Because we haven't saved this instruction, this address earlier. If we would have saved this address earlier, probably we have to just take that address from that place and then we can load this value here. I hope this point is clear. Let me repeat again. You know that return statement wants us to go back. To go back to in the main program, but we cannot go back to the main program just like that. This is a CPU. It works on addresses. It needs certain instructions, right? So it always keep the path in the reminder folder, which is reminder folder is what? Program counter. It will let him know that, okay, if you have executed this instruction, now you have to switch to this address and go and implement and go and execute the instruction from this address. But now program counter has 106 because we are working on this return statement. Once this return statement will execute it, he will know, okay, this is no more useful code. This is no more useful address for his processing. He has to go back to the main code. But unfortunately, while he was coming here, he could not save the data. He could not save the address 0A hex. So that is the point where we come to the stake concept, and let me draw it for you. Okay, I have drawn a special stake over here. I hope you can see. It is just a storage place. So what is going to happen when this call instruction will be executing very first time? Let me raise some of the stuff so that you can understand. You know that when this instruction is under the execution, which instruction? The call instruction, and his address is 06. So the next address is 0A, which is the address of move WF port D, right? So 0A is stored in the program counter. And when this instruction finishes, what is going to happen? Then we have to switch to the double, and double address is 100. Okay, this is 100, right? So 100 should be loaded over here. But before loading 100 into program counter, what is going to happen? The original content or the present content of program counter must be saved somewhere. And this is a place which is called stake. Here we come to the word stake. So what is going to happen? This 0A, right? It will not simply flushed or it will not simply raised. It will go up, come up here, right? 0A hex. Okay, why I'm not writing in the start? This is a concept that I still need to explain. So I'm not writing in the very first location, but in the next location. So earlier, something which was keeping the track of stake itself, right? Like program counter, it keeps the track of program memory. So there is something which is called SP, and what is SP? I'm going to discuss it, but later on. But it keeps the track of stake itself. How many values are stored inside the stake? So it always, if stake is empty, earlier, I mean, in this example, we haven't used stake earlier. So this stake was empty, right? I'm sorry. So this stake was empty, right? So stake SP was pointing to the very first location and it is never used. So what is going to happen when this 0A hex is moved in this stake? So this will switch. I mean, this SP will point to now this location, and this this is no more over here, right? So this SP, what is this SP? SP is called stake pointer, the pointer of a stake, a register which always points to the current value which is used in a stake, right? So this is the location which is used in the stake now. As I told you, the very first location of the stake will never used, right? So we will not save any data in the very first location. So second location is used, and in second location, what we have done, we have saved the value of current value of program counter. So now we can simply raise the value in the program counter, right? And program counter is empty, but that value is stored in the stake, and this is pointed by stake pointer. So the last value which is filled in the stake is pointed by stake pointer. This is the definition of stake pointer as well. So stake pointer is a register which points to the location which is used the last time in the stake, right? Or the topmost value in the stake, right? Whatever the way you explain, but this is like that. Okay. We come back to the program counter. Now the value of 0A, which was stored in the program counter, has gone to this stake. So now what will happen, it will simply store the address of this double, which is 100 hex. Then it will become 102, 104. And as I told you, finally, it will become 106 when this next free address is being pointed. Okay, let me clearly written it so that it becomes clear. So it will become 106, right? So this is the address of the next free location after this is returned. But when this return statement will execute it, what will happen? CPU will know, okay, this is not the correct address. Now I have to switch back to the main code. And how I can come back to the main code? I need stake value. So the last value which was present in the stake, or which was pushed in the stake. Okay, this is the term that we used. When we say the value is stored in the stake, we say we push the value. And when we say we retrieve the value from the stake, we use the word pop. So last time value was pushed, or last time value was stored in the stack. So 0A was pushed value in the stake, and it will come back, or it will pop out, right? It will pop up the value, and where it will come back, it will come back in its original position, which is the program counter. So what is going to happen? What is going to happen here? We will see that 0A will be written. Okay. And in this way, program counter will come back to its main or original position. I hope you understand this concept. And then what is going to happen? We execute this instruction. So 0C will be pointed, right? Because this is the next instruction. Then we will again branch again. Okay. When this branch statement is going to be executed, what is the next address? Next address would be 0E, right? But once this branch execution will be happening, it will come to know, okay, this is a branch. So I have to go back to again label. Again label will point towards 04. So again, this 04 will be loaded, then 06, then 0A, and then it will flush out. It will go to the stake. We will run this 100, 102, 104, 106, and then we will use back this 0A. So in this way, you know, you understand, you flow the program, or in this way it is flowed, right? So this stake concept is very important because it makes sure that we never lose our track of the program, and we can always return back to the main code where we have actually called a subroutine which shifted us from the main code to the subroutine code. I hope you understand these concepts. Okay. So some of the things which are still need to be explained, let me explain you. So I have cleared all the stuff, and this is the same code. This is the same mistake, and this is the same program counter. Okay. One thing is still need to be adjusted. Okay. This should be here. And one thing we're missing here. Let me write it for us, which is this stake pointer. So this stake pointer is pointing this first location. And so first of all, we need to understand what is a stake pointer. Stake pointer is again itself is a register, right? So it is simply a register which will hold the addresses of stake, right? Y address is because stack itself is a memory. It has number of locations. So we want to refer to any specific location. So this is very first location, then second and third and so on. So first of all, we come to the point, what is the size of stack in the program, in the PIC18F microcontroller or PIC18F452. So size of stack is around 32 bytes, right? Or you can say 32 locations, the size of not bytes, 32 locations. So there are 32 locations. So if you number them, it will be very first location. It will be 0, 1, 2. And this process will continue till the last location. And the last location address would be what? 31. I have just addressed it in the decimal number system, because that is why I'm starting with 0 and finishing it at 31. So there are 32 locations. Very first location is 0 hex, which is pointed by stack pointer if stack is empty, right? If stack is not empty, then it will point to certain value, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So the maximum location it can actually go up to 31th location, right? Or there are 32 locations, one of them is not useful. So that is why we say only 31 time this stack can be used. So this is also the maximum limit of calls instruction that you can use in your program, because every time you're gonna use call instruction, you have to place certain value inside stack. Remember, if you use one call, we simply put one value here, which is the address of the next instruction of this call, right? 0A was placed in this location. Let me show you. In this location, 0A was placed. If you use another call, you have to place some other values, right? So how many values you can push, since we cannot use this value, we can use this location, this and onwards. So 31 call statement can be used, and 31 is the maximum location of the stack as well, but the size of location is 32. Now we come to the point, what is the width of this stack? This is a very interesting point. I mean, the width of this stack. Width means the number of bits which is stored in every location, right? Since we know that program memory, each location can carry 1 byte. File register, each location can carry 1 byte. So what is the capacity of each location of a stack? The capacity of each location of a stack is equal to the width of the program counter. So what is the width of the program counter? If you remember, we have already discussed it. What is the width of the program counter? This is interesting. This, it will be the same, the capacity of one single location of a stack, because it will be storing the value which can be stored in the program counter. Or you can say the content of program counter is going to push or pop out into the program counter in stack, right? So that means, what is the width of program counter? And the program counter width, if you remember, it is equal to 21 bits. Why? Because our addresses are 21 bit address. If you remember, our full memory is 2 MB. Right, which can be possible with 2 raised to 21. That means 21 bit address is used, and that 21 bit dictates the width of the program counter and so on. So it also dictates the width of stack. So 21 bits of each location, right? That means every location of stack can store 21 bits, right? And how many locations can be stored? 31 locations, right? What is the maximum size of stack? 32 locations. They can be numbered from 0 to 31, and each location can carry 21 bits. Okay, this address is still in decimal. We know that we normally use hexadecimal. So for hexadecimal entries, you need to know that if you convert 31 or 0 in hexadecimal, what it will become? 00 will be equal to 00 hex, right? And 31 will be equal to 1F. I hope you can use your hexadecimal conversion, 01 hex, 02 hex, 03 hex, and it will go up to 1F hex, because 1F hex is equal to 31 in decimal, right? So the maximum or the largest address possible in stack is equal to, let me write it again, the maximum address can be used in stack is equal to 1f. So 1f is the last location which can be used in stack, and the 00 hex is the very first location of the stack, but it never used the very first location which will be used is 01 hex. Then 02 hex, 03 hex, 04 hex, and we will move onwards and we will reach eventually to 1f hex, and this is the last location of a stake which can be used. I hope you have understand the concept of stake. We discuss why program counter needs to have a reminder of the value so that it can keep the track of the main program, and this is possible only with the use of a stake, right? Then we discuss how many locations are there. There are 32 locations in stake, right? And then we discussed each location is composition of 21 bits because it holds the content of program counter, which is 21 bit long, right? Then we discussed the very first location can never be used, which is zero in decimal or 00 hex in hexadecimal, right? And the maximum last location which can be used in address is 31th in decimal, but in hexadecimal is address would be 1f hex. These are the many underlying concept of a stack in PIC18F microcontroller. I hope you have understand all these concept. If still you have any query, you need to post your comments in comment section. That's it from this lecture. Thank you so much for listening.